to the idea when we went to a conference and they were celebrating the historians of that city. And so they had different pieces of art, different things like that, just to celebrate historical places and historical figures in their city. So we saw that and we thought, how can we make that better for the city of Monrovia? How can we celebrate the people that we care about? So we thought of a way to celebrate our unsung heroes that introduced public art as well. And so we're going to go ahead and get into it. So we find someone who we think is very important, or a group of someone that's done something great for the city and the community at large. And we work with local artists to make sure that they can get an awesome art piece to reflect who that person or those persons are. And then from there, we get the art piece going. And then we have a celebration, which we're doing here today. So if you go on the city's website, cityofmonrovia.org/neighborhood treasures, you can see more information about our three previous treasures. Also, we have a table over there that has some information on our neighborhood treasures, so you can see who we've also celebrated in the past. And after the art unveiling, there's going to be several different things for us to do, including eating lunch, which I know people are very excited about. And then we also have water. So if you guys ever get overheated or anything like that, we do have some water that is already available for everybody. So now I'm going to recognize our city historian, Steve Baker, and he is going to talk about the life of some of the Japanese Monrovians.
First of all, the setting. The Monrovia of 1900 had a population of 1,205. The local economy was still depressed after the collapse of the land boom, and citrus fruit was the biggest cash crop. Most of the city of Monrovia north of Foothill Boulevard was covered with citrus trees, and citrus groves existed south of Foothill as well. Monrovia Canyon Park was a hiking destination, and Library Park did not exist. The Monrovia Public Library and the Monrovia City Hall were in the Granite Bank building at the corner of Palm and Myrtle. Electricity had just come to Monrovia. There were no automobiles. And the only Japanese representation in Monrovia was George, a member of the household of Colonel R.M. Baker, the corner of Hillcrest and Alta Vista. In 1903, the Pacific Electric Railway arrived in Monrovia and the city began to grow once again. Also in 1903, Yutaro Ueda arrived in California from Japan. 4 years later, Satoru Tsunishi, as well as Shojiro Morimoto, arrived in California from Japan. Shojiro had married Ito Tochioka in 1902, and they became the parents of 8 children. Are there any Morimoto descendants here today? 1910, the population of Monrovia had grown substantially. It was 3,505 people, about 1/10 of the size of Monrovia today. Citrus was still the biggest cash crop, and the Japanese population of Monrovia began to grow. 7 Japanese males were living in Monrovia, 5 were working in private families, and 2 were employed at the Lista Grand Hotel as a chef and kitchen helper. Satoru Tsunishi became a permanent resident. Dr. Blanche Weston, for whom he worked, encouraged Satoru to attend Monrovia High School, even though he had already graduated from the equivalent in Japan. He graduated in 1913, and was the oldest living graduate when he died at the age of 99 in 1987. 1913, the first Japanese business in Monrovia, the Japanese fruit and vegetable market, was located at 714 South Myrtle Avenue, and was owned by a gentleman named, first name I initial, and last name Doi, D-O-I. And Shijiro Morimoto was living at 817 South Magnolia and selling fruit door to door. As I came here today, I passed by the little house that still exists at 817 South Magnolia, where that family had their Monrovia beginnings. 1914, Satoru Tsunishi returned to Japan to marry Sho Murakami, and they became the parents of 10 children. And I know there are Tsunishi descendants here today. 1915, Takumi Asano arrived in California, Japan, and initially lived in Fresno. But by 1917, he was living in Duarte, working on the William Baird Ranch. Satoru Tsunishi was farming in Duarte, and Yutaro Ueda was farming in Duarte as well. 1919, the market operated by this time the Doi brothers was located at 709 South Myrtle Avenue. Yutaro Ueda married Naka Shinohara in San Francisco, and they became the parents of 3 children, a son and 2 daughters. 1920, the building had grown again to about 10,000 people. Satoru Tsuneishi was farming on West Gordy Road in Monrovia, not too far from here. Takumi Asano was working for the Arthur Evers family on Highland Place. And Yutaro Ueda was farming in Duwarty. Shigeru Momoto was also ranching in Monrovia. 1920, the federal census reflected 71 residents of Japanese ancestry living in the Monrovia, Duwarty area. A year later, in 1921, Takumi Asano married Sakaya Doi in Okayama, Japan, and they became the presence of two daughters, their descendants are represented today. 1925, Takumi Asano took over the operation of the market at 709 South Myrtle Avenue. Yutaro Ueda was living at 331 West Huntington Drive, and the legend of the strawberry king of Monrovia began in some of his descendants there as well. The other day I was asked about the location of the market. It was originally at 709 South Myrtle, but later on it was located at 617 South Myrtle Avenue, and that location still exists today. That takes in about 25 years of local history. That'll give you some idea of the Monrovia that these Japanese pioneers came to, the occupations they engaged in, and the fact that they put down roots and flourished. Thank you very much. It's been my pleasure to talk to you about these people and the place they occupied in Monrovia history. And as I talked to my sister this morning, I told her I was going to be speaking to the dedication this morning of the Japanese pioneers of Monrovia. Her comment was, "It's about time." And that's my sentiment as well. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Steve. Now we are going to have Ms. Susie Lane give a specific history for Japanese Monrovians.
Let me tell you, my name is Susie Lane and I teach history at Pasadena City College. I used to live in another part of the San Gabriel Valley, which was closer to the Southern Pacific Railroads. Every day, the sounds of the trains were a part of our lives. But one day, I thought to myself, hey, did the Chinese pioneers help build this segment of the railroad too? And that's what got me curious about Asian American history in the local San Gabriel Valley. To be honest, I haven't found too much about the early Chinese or Filipino Manongs of this valley. But in my search, I got introduced to Bacon Sakatani. And Bacon is with us today, as always, with his camera. Bacon is like the godfather of Japanese Americans in the San Gabriel Valley. It was like I found Wakanda and the vibranium source. It was like I found the gold of El Dorado. So much of ethnic history is lost. Local history, especially, depends on people like Bacon Sakatani and the award-winning Steve Baker. The survival of local history depends on hoarders, journalists, catalogers, videographers, photographers, librarians, oral historians, scanners, and city staff like Carrie Zeso over here, and under the team of Ariel Tolofri Williams and city manager Oliver Chi. Local history, especially ethnic history, needs people to care. And in Monrovia, we have people who care. And so this neighborhood treasure represents care. It represents exactly that. I have to mention the families who are today remembered for their contributions to Monrovia. Monrovia families include the Kawaguchis, the Kurumiyas, who are here today, the Mimakis, the Morimotos, who are here today. Where'd they go? The ladies, the Morimoto granddaughters, the Soyashimas, the Tsuneishis, who are here today. Other families include the Hoshinos, the Sawadas, the Morishitas, the Fujimotos, the Kokuyagas, the Nitakes. I'm sorry, I forgot the Dois, of course. The Kunimotos, and perhaps more. And today we also have Ted Hashimoto from the neighboring town of Arcadia, who graduated from Monrovia Arcadia Duarte in 1941. I have the great honor of introducing some of these Monrovia descendants to you today. Lori Keiko Sakatani is the granddaughter of Yutaro and Naka Ueda, and their family brought out their tiller. I think that's called a tiller. I really don't know what it's called. Yutaro was Monrovia's strawberry king on Huntington Drive, a couple blocks here, next to today's living spaces. Barbara Asano is the granddaughter of Takumi and Sakai Asano, who Steve said ran the grocery store on Myrtle, the Asano Fruit and Grocery Store. And we also have with us Marvin Inuit. Marvin grew up in the southeast section of Monrovia, and he was best buds with many of the African-American families that are also part of Monrovia's legacy. So we will now have the families come up and speak. So we'll start out with Keiko.
One of the things that inspired me for today is Susie, because she had an opportunity to speak to my mother when she was 93. My mother passed away at 94 years old last year. And so she was still very lucid about the history. And so speaking to Susie, when we left after she interviewed my mother, she said to me, she wanted to thank my mother and our families because of their history and what they did and how they worked the land and what they endured made it easier for her. So I really appreciate that because it's opened my eyes to a whole new history for me because I grew up with this and it was just something that happened. But now as I read more about it, it gets me more emotional because of the tragedy of some of the things that have occurred, the racism, the bigotry that my grandparents, my parents, and still today, that we still experience. And so one of the things I wanted to read to you, and then I'll continue, and I brought some pictures. You won't be able to see a lot from where you are, but I'll leave it over there on the table. But one of the things that affected my mother deeply, the daughter of the Strawberry King, the Japanese were not able to become citizens of the United States until 1952. My grandfather loved Monrovia. He prospered in Monrovia. He had very good friends in Monrovia. His children are born in Monrovia. My mother was born right around where the Monrovia Airport used to be. So he died in 1949. That was 3 years before the Japanese were allowed to become naturalized citizens. And I was thinking back, boy, he would have been thrilled to be an American. But he was an American in spirit and in heart because of what he contributed to society and his relationships with the people in town. So I just wanted to read this to you because my mother, when the Japanese were incarcerated and taken to the concentration camps, first at what they called the reception center at Pomona Fairgrounds and then to the concentration camp at Heart Mountain, Wyoming, where many of you are familiar with, and some of you have maybe even families have been to Nansenar. But one of the things that meant so much to my mother was this letter from George Bush. She framed it and put it on the wall. And I'd like to read it to you if I may. From the White House and the seal of the President of the United States, a monetary sum and words alone cannot restore lost years or erase painful memories. Neither can they fully convey our nation's resolve to rectify injustice and to uphold the rights of individuals. We can never fully right the wrongs of the past, but we can take a clear stand for justice and recognize that serious injustices were done to Japanese Americans during World War II. In enacting the law calling for restitution and offering a sincere apology, your fellow Americans have and a very real sense, we meet their traditional commitment to the ideals of freedom, equality, and justice. You and your family have our best wishes for the future. So let that sink in and see where we are today. I'm sorry. And so this is my grandfather. You can see he was in a tux with a white bow tie. I think this was taken a lot younger when he was in Japan. And Steve had told you about the history. He came in the early 1900s and he built the railroad, not the railroad, the streetcar tracks, the red line that came through Monrovia and it ended here. And so this is where he settled, in Monrovia, and he loved it here. It was a land of opportunity, and like many Asians that came here, it was a land of opportunity. It was a gold land where they would come and they could get rich quick. My grandfather on my dad's side did the same thing, came to the United States, had four children, he went back to Japan, and what made him prosperous, he grew potatoes for the army in fields outside of downtown LA. And so the strawberry king remained. This is a picture of them growing up, my mother, my aunt, and Yutaro, and my grandmother. There was a son, but he was killed riding one of the horses that they used in the farm. So this is a picture too that will show some information. They'll show you what Huntington Drive looked like. Oh, it showed what Huntington Drive looked like and where their berry stand was located, where the living spaces is standing right now. Mm-hmm. And how quiet the street was. This was nothing but orange groves. And we had a cat that used to cross Huntington Drive to get food and then come back. Cat couldn't do that now, it would never survive. But you'll get an idea of what the family looked like. We were family, ordinary people. There wasn't anything scary about us. Not what the newspapers talked about, the yellow peril, that we were dangerous, we could be subversive. The propaganda was just amazing. And I've since looked at some of the pictures of the yellow journalism. It's horrifying what they did. And so if you can learn to hate it because it's so ugly and there's such terrible people, you can incarcerate it, you can kill it with an atomic bomb. And so those are memories that kind of have been triggered. I didn't name for this to be a political thing, but it's just
history.
History, you're right, yeah. It is history. And we need to remember that history, because some of the things that we did, we as Americans did, was cruel and was barbarous. And so hopefully as we go forward, as George Bush has said, Clinton also wrote a letter, which I think is a little bit more accurate. So if you ever have a chance to research that, George Bush, Clinton, and I think the other Bush also, but Clinton had a little bit more to it. Just one other thing I want to say, because I think this is important. I went to the dedication for the plaque to commemorate the memories of the reception center that was at the Pomona Fairgrounds. I didn't realize they had barracks there also, and people living in horse stalls also for the time. Many of you were there. One of the things that was most humiliating for my mother was to have a tag attached by string with a number on it while she was processed into the reception center. So the plaque at the Pomona Fairgrounds is amazing, because what it talks about is that the Japanese were here because of racism and bigotry. And they spent so many months here at the time of war because we happened to look like the enemy. The plaque that's at the Santa Anita Fairgrounds, I read that and I was furious, because what that says is that the Japanese were here because of a project of the army. And I thought, what? So anyway, it goes on. And I'm just really pleased and honored to be a part of this recognition and to really honor each of us that we're here, that our grandparents sacrificed a lot for us, mm-hmm. and we are successful, we're prosperous, and we're proud.
Thank you.
Thank you. So officially her name's Lori, but we call her Keiko.
Oh, That's another story.
So here comes Barbara Asano, granddaughter of the Takami and Sakai Asano.
1915, 20-year-old Takami Asano came to the United States and worked on a ranch in Milwaukee. Around 1920, he went back to Japan and returned to the U.S. with a young bride, Sakaya. Takami and Sakai, or Tom and Mary, as they would be known in town, raised two sons, Toshio and Warren, also known as Bay, both born in Monrovia. Tom and Mary operated a grocery store on Middle Avenue. Many other Japanese families worked local farms which supplied the produce. For the Asano Grocery, Toshio and Babe attended Santa Fe Elementary School, Ivy Avenue, which is Clifton Middle, Monrovia Arcadia DeWardy High School. They attended a Japanese language school in Monrovia, and Mary Ueda Sakatani was a classmate. By the fifth grade, both Coach and Babe discovered sports and excelled in them, football, basketball, baseball, and track. They were both lettered in multiple sports at MAD. Coach would graduate MAD and go on to Citrus College. Babe's high school years were cut short due to internment, as was Coach's outstanding football career at Citrus College. The family would live the rest of their life. In Monrovia, except for interruption from 1942 to 1946 as a result of Japan's attack at Pearl Harbor, Hawaii. Due to wartime hysteria by Executive Order 9066, all persons of Japanese ancestry, citizens and non-citizens, were ordered removed from the West Coast and moved to interior states. In 1942, most all Japanese and Japanese American Monrovians were temporarily detained at Pomona Fairgrounds, their permanent housing via Hard Mountain, Wyoming. The relocation centers were concentration camps with thin-walled barracks built on barren, desolate lands surrounded by barbed wire and guard towers with armed soldiers. Toshio and Babe joined the U.S. Army when their draft notices reached them at Hard Mountain. Babe served in Europe and Toshio the Pacific as MIS, Military Intelligence Service. The segregated Japanese-American units were the most decorated for their life, for their side. In 2011, the Japanese-American Army units collected the Congressional Gold Medal issued by the U.S. Congress, Toshio and Babe included. After the war, when released from Hart Mountain, Tom and Mary were fortunate to return to their home in Monrovia. Many families returned the West Coast to nothing. Upon discharge, Toshio and Babe also returned to Monrovia. The life was not the same. They could not return to their former jobs. Tom would become a gardener and Mary turned to housekeeping for a living. Babe also became a gardener. Still active in sports, Toshio worked odd jobs so he could still continue playing softball, where he would eventually become an auto mechanic.
Mrs. Cordelia.
Thank you. Toshio and Babe would marry and raise their daughters in Monrovia, who also attended Monrovia Elementary, Clifton, Santa Fe High, and Monrovia High. Toshio's wife, Terry, worked in the counseling office at Monrovia High School for probably 20 years plus. So three generations of the Asano family, Issei, Nisi, and Sansei, communicatively, almost 100 years, have lived their lives in our hometown of Monrovia.
Thank you very much, Barbara Asano. Asano's 100 plus years in the city of Monrovia. Marvin, can you top that? This is Marvin Inoue. Retired high school teacher. Oh, he's known as Oka.
Good afternoon, everyone.
What?
Again. My name is Marvin Inoue. No relation to the famous senator from Hawaii, but I grew up in Monrovia in the 1950s through the 80s and knew several of the Japanese American families who helped build the community of Monrovia. This city has its roots around the turn of the century when the first immigrants from Japan began arriving in large numbers due to the American government passing the Exclusionary Act of 1882. Chinese Exclusionary Act of 1882. The American businessmen, still wanting inexpensive labor, encouraged Japanese, Korean, Filipino, and Asian Indians to come and help build our railroads, work in our lumber industry, work in our canneries, and help our American farmers. Currently, I'm a volunteer in training at the Japanese American National Museum in Los Angeles. What I have learned in the process is that the Japanese American farmers, before the war, had become extremely successful by bringing their gardening skills in soil preparation, farming techniques, thriftiness, perseverance of working long, tedious hours with wives and children, and their managerial skills. This helped them to maximize crop yield per acre, harvesting 2 to 3 times more as opposed per year as to the one. This allowed several families I knew to have produce stands or stores to provide fruits and vegetables to this community. Again, they've mentioned all the names, the Asanos, the Tsuneshis, the Sakatanis, Uedas. I can't name all of them because I just found out about some today. After the war, many families had difficulty restarting their businesses, and the majority of men that came back to the West Coast became gardeners. I remember vividly Henry Hoshino and Clevy Brown playing football and running track and field at Monrovia High School when I was in elementary school. And then the Sakatane and Uera girls that are here today. Got stories about them in terms of some of you may not know the term majorettes. They were all majorettes. Those are people that twirl the baton. And I distinctly remember going to see halftime shows at Monrovia High School where there was fire on the batons, and that totally stunned me. But along with them, the Sakatani Uera girls were the Mimaki girls, the Sandy and Barbie Fujimoto, the Soyashima family, the Morishita, the Sawada, the Inoue boys and girls, being not only the majorettes and cheerleaders, but mascots as well as being as USB cabinet officers and athletes at Monrovia High School. We are fortunate that the Historical Society of Monrovia is working to preserve history of all Monrovia's past and present residents. I would personally like to thank Susie Ling for contacting me to speak here today. Again, I was not here before the war. I came after the war. My dad had graduated college before and ended up being a school teacher out at Heart Mountain. And I know Bacon Sakatani because I'm on the Heart Mountain Reunion Committee. I'd also like to thank the people that I know. I know I'm going to forget someone, but Ralph Walker, Betty Sanford, and Lois Gaston, because they're part of the Historical Society here in Monrovia. Thank you very much.
Are you ready for the most exciting part? Yeah. Mary Rose Mendoza. Mary Rose was born, come on up, Mary Rose. She was born in Manila, but she grew up in the San Gabriel Valley, and she's a drawing teacher at Pasadena City College. She joined the Monrovia contest because she is from Monrovia, and she also wanted to give tribute to the pioneers before us. Mary Rose is going to say a few words.
Thank you, Susie. And thank you all for coming today. I'd also like to thank the City of Monrovia, the Neighborhood Treasures Committee, Carrie Zasau, Dan Sargent, and the Issei, Nisei, and Sansei communities for the opportunity to create an artwork recognizing the contributions of Japanese American pioneers in our city and our country. In 2018, I took a sabbatical from teaching drawing at Pasadena City College. Part of this time was used to travel to Japan to explore Shoto, Japanese calligraphy, and also to create new artwork for a solo exhibition. During my explorations, I began a journey of discovery into my own Filipino-American history. What I uncovered was a history that was not at all reflected in my education in the United States. So when I learned there was an opportunity to create an artwork commemorating Asian American pioneers in Monrovia, I felt compelled to participate. My Asian Pacific American experience and the experiences of Asian Americans are American stories. My parents immigrated to Los Angeles in 1969, and my brother, sister, and I came shortly after when I was 3 years old in 1970. We frequented the Far East Cafe in Little Tokyo, as well as places in Chinatown and historic Filipino town. In the beginning, my extended family was a couple of Titos and one Tita, who eventually married my Uncle Ray, who is of Japanese Hawaiian descent. My early childhood memories embrace this hybrid of Asian Pacific American cultures. Sorry. I am honored to showcase just some of the many Japanese American pioneers who have contributed to the histories of the city of Monrovia and the United States. I hope this plaque will be one of many reminders of how Monrovia and America have always been enriched by a diverse legacy. The image you will see today is what is currently in production at the MC Foundry in Hawthorne. The piece will be made of bronze and cast in a wood-like patina. I hope you will come by and visit again to see the final plaque that honors this important history. Thank you.
Thank you, Mary Rose. Really quick, before we do the unveiling, there's two individuals that the city of Monrovia wanted to thank today. First, we'd like to call up Mr. Steve Baker. As everybody knows, he's our historian and city treasurer and recent award recipient. Mr. Baker continually provides support to the Neighborhood Treasures Program, and he really is the heart of the program. He provides all the data and the fact checking and comes out and speaks every time, and we're very blessed to have you be part of this team. Thank you very much. Next, we would like to recognize Mrs. Susie Ling. Susie Ling is the reason that we're all here today, so let's give her a giant round of applause. This was Susie's passion and idea to bring this, and when we first met with her a few years ago to get some information from her, she brought this idea forward, and she has been the leading force and the heart of this exact project. We could have not done this without her today, and so with that, we say thank you so much for making this happen. We appreciate everything you've done.
The city of Monrovia has a sidewalk poetry program, and so as we've been redoing the sidewalks, we've been adding poems from various residents and city staff members from around the city. And so we have one here, and actually the person that wrote the poem, his name is Karen Steiner. He's here today, so where is he at? There he is. Karen Steiner wrote the poem, and I'm going to read it for you, so make sure you also read it while you are looking at the art piece. It says, "Step off the street. Be still and feel the earth, its silent drum. Look up and hear the foothills whisper, an endless, timeless chant. Watch the mountains, motionless, yet rising toward eternity." Karen, thank you so much for making such a beautiful poem so we can add to this.